When Michelangelo was painting the Sistine Chapel ceiling, he designed and built his own scaffolding. But it only covered half of the ceiling, so he painted the first half of the ceiling, then removed the scaffolding. When he finally got to view his work from the floor, 70 feet below, it was as if he were seeing it with new eyes. After 2 years of work, he didn't like what he saw. This is Love Your Work, and I'm David Cadavy. Michelangelo faced what I call the finisher's paradox. There's a contradiction that happens when you try to ship your work. By the time you're done, you can already do better. You learned in the process. As I talked about in episode 262, Michelangelo aimed left when he started painting in the chapel. He had little experience as a painter and even less experience in the wickedly difficult fresco method. He knew the first panel he painted wouldn't be his best. So, as art historian Ross King explained on episode 99, Michelangelo started in an inconspicuous part of the chapel. It was the last place the clergy entering the chapel would see, and the last place the Pope would look when sitting on the throne. Michelangelo did have at least one false start. A few weeks into painting the first panel, he wasn't satisfied with his work. The salty sea air in Italy was staining the mixture of plaster he had chosen. There were probably also some things he wanted to change about his painting style. Once the plaster on a fresco dries, it's literally set in stone. But like stone, you can get rid of it if you destroy it. And that's exactly what he did. Michelangelo chipped away 3 weeks' worth of work and started over. If Michelangelo learned a thing or two in the first few weeks painting the Sistine Chapel, you can bet he learned even more painting the rest of the 12,000 square foot fresco, which, in total, took him 4 years. So after Michelangelo removed his scaffolding from the first half of the ceiling, he was faced with a dilemma. There was something he didn't like about his work. Since while painting on his scaffolding he was very close to the work looked very different from the floor. He realized the scenes he had painted were too complex. There were too many people on each panel, and as a result, the people were too small. You couldn't make out very well from the floor what was going on in the paintings on the ceiling. The dilemma, then, was that he was 2 years into the work. His patron, Pope Julius II, was a nasty man, known for going on tirades and beating people who disagreed with him, perhaps even worse. He's gone down in history as Il Papa Terribile, or the Terrible Pope. He had probably even beaten Michelangelo by that point. Additionally, the project was taking a toll on Michelangelo. His back was killing him from literally bending over backwards to paint the ceiling. So, would Michelangelo do as he did when he first started the project? Chip away all that work, put the scaffolding back up, then start over? Or would he keep going and ship the work? Michelangelo was faced with the finisher's paradox. He had learned a lot throughout the project, and he had learned even more by finally seeing his work from a distance. Would he fix what was wrong with his work, or would he just ship it as it was, flaws and all? Since the Sistine Chapel ceiling has lived on as one of the greatest masterpieces in art, it's surprising Michelangelo saw something wrong at all. It's even more surprising that what he saw is still there in the final product. If you look closely at the Sistine Chapel ceiling today, you'll notice something different about the two halves of the ceiling. On one side of the ceiling, the scenes are complex. There are lots of people and the people are small. On the other side, the scenes are simpler. There are fewer people in each panel, and the people are bigger. When the first half of the ceiling was unveiled, it didn't seem to matter to others that the people in the paintings were small. Raphael was so impressed by what he saw, he went back to one of his own frescoes, the School of Athens, chipped away a spot, and in its place painted a likeness of Michelangelo. But Michelangelo himself made some big changes to his approach, and these changes seem to have paid off. The very first panel he painted on the second half of the ceiling is one of the most famous paintings ever. In the creation of Adam, you see God himself giving life to Adam from fingertip to fingertip. Like other panels on the second half of the ceiling, there are fewer main figures, in this case two, and as a result, they're bigger and easier to see from the floor. In the process of doing your creative work, you learn. This is especially true because nobody can teach you how to do your creative work with the unique style and idiosyncrasies that make it yours. Yes, there will be creative waste. Much of it goes into building the underwater part of your iceberg. As you get shiny object syndrome and switch from one project to another, as you scrap iterations by throwing them into the fire, and as projects simply fail, for now, there will be delays in achieving success as you build your foundation. But just because waste, false starts, and failures are a part of the creative process, doesn't mean you can hide away forever, toiling on a perfect masterpiece you will one day unveil. Shipping is a skill, and learning new skills is sometimes scary. Remember from episode 265 that one of the sub-skills of shipping is overcoming perfectionism. Perfectionism is a humble brag of a quality. It's far easier and more comfortable to say you're still working on your masterpiece than it is to put it into the world and see how it's received. But as Maya Angelou once said, do the best you can until you know better. Then when you know better, do better. In other words, beware the finisher's paradox. When you work on a creative project, you learn. Once it's time to ship, you can already do better. You can't ship your work without some small part of you saying, this sucks. It is better to build in enlightenment than to daydream in darkness. Thank you for having me on your podcast. Thank you to Chris Parker at Easy Prey and Joyce Ling at the Abundance Podcast. You can find every podcast I've been on at catavy.net/interviews. One thing I've learned in over a decade as an independent creator is to invest in ideas. They really are everything. Most of them don't work out, but the ones that do can be big. I had one idea that led to a book deal and transformed my life. I had another idea that connected me with a company that later sold to Google, which brought a surprise payday. Big ideas start small, and the place I share my ideas first is my weekly newsletter. It's called Love Mondays, and each week I share a big little idea about how to break through to become a true original and make it as a creator. I also share my favorite quotes and books and tools for thought. Think of Love Mondays as like a shot of creative fuel to start off your week. There's several thousand subscribers. We're having a good time. Join Love Mondays at kdv.co/newsletter. That's kdv.co/newsletter. You might have noticed I don't have ads on Love Your Work. I haven't had them for a long time now. In fact, a big company whose name you would definitely recognize offered me money to advertise in this show recently, and I had to turn it down. Why? Because some money feels good, some money feels not as good. When I see that somebody bought one of my books, that feels good. When a company advertises on the show, I mean, it's money, but that doesn't feel quite as good. Another kind of money that feels really good is the money I get from my Patreon supporters. It feels like an honest exchange. It's a vote of confidence that they like the show. Since I myself support a number of creators on Patreon, I know it feels good to vote with my dollars and support the kind of work I would like to see in the world. And that's what I'm trying to do here. Make the kind of podcast I want to listen to and share the ideas I want to see in the world. So if you like the show, a great way to let me know is to support the show on Patreon. Even a few bucks a month helps. It really adds up over all the dedicated listeners, and it motivates me to keep doing what I'm doing. If you'd like to support the show, visit the Patreon page at patreon.com/catavy. You'll see the different levels and perks available. Even if you're on the fence, check out the page. Again, it's at patreon.com/catavy. That's patreon.com/catavy. Thanks for your support. Love Your Work is brought to you exclusively by our Patreon supporters, including top supporters Jeffrey Mason, Bob Rosen, and Pravin Shaker. The theme music for Love Your Work is At Sea by Durena from the album About Everything and More by arrangement with Deep Elm Records at deepelm.com. Love Your Work is a production of Catavy, Inc.